truly African.
Well, hello and welcome to this edition of Talk Time. And this week, we are talking about roads. Welcome to Talk Time.
Hey, Bukuya. If you don't have the pressure, I told me to say, I told you to come from the family. You said the people are here and I saw you. They said when you're Joe, what? What do you want?
My new son came to me, Kaba.
Ah, ma.
We are real the men are not true, and it's the mamma to craft for us.
Any baby say, Finn, Yako, Christmas, and Mammy, you must show me.
Go feature. Why, yes, and I am a young yammy. And as a who knows who bow one of the gallery, and a makoti proving kind of friend with Arab basin tablets. So, wouldn't somebody ring your banana? And no tin and I'm sure my potter said, Brady, I brought a tip. No.
Arab basin bet my way in our mammy. And ye be very soft.
William, who your batter a woman will ban you for, and now Quada won't in fear do me and one. Won't come.
Araba Bazen.
And there I see.
Hello and welcome once again to Talk Time. And this week we're going to be talking about roads, the state of roads in our country. What is happening? I mean, after the declaration of Year of Roads and so on, it doesn't appear that a lot is happening. And today we have the privilege of talking to Honorable Isaac Ajay Mensa, who used to be a Deputy Minister of Roads and is currently a member of the Parliamentary Committee on Roads and Transport, I suppose. So you're welcome to the studio.
Thank you, Kwesi.
Now, in Parliament, what are you doing about the state of roads in this country?
Thank you very much, Kwesi, and I'm privileged to be here. I think I'm coming to this station for the first time.
Wow.
I used to monitor you outside, and so I'm honored to be here, especially going to talk about roads. As you rightly said, I am the deputy ranking for the Committee of Roads and Transport, and the former Deputy Minister for Roads and Highways. And because I'm privileged and honored to be here for the first time, I probably have to request that I extend my greetings to constituents. So people who are watching me for the first time, the good people of Asa East and our cherished, you know, viewers. You know, the basic function of the Roads and Transport Committee is to provide oversight, the normal parliamentary oversighting on the ministry. So we have three major ministries on us. That means Ministry of Roads and Highways. On the Ministry of Roads and Highways, we have these major agencies, the Ghana Highways Authority, which is an authority responsible for trunk roads and so on. Then urban roads and roads in the municipalities and urban centers, and also the Department of Feeder Roads, basically for our feeder roads in the rural areas and so on. Then we have Transport Ministry, and these days the Transport Ministry has embedded in it the aviation, formerly the Ministry of Aviation. Then again, the Ministry of Railways. So these are the various ministries that are under the committee that we have oversight responsibility towards them. So basically, what do they do with their budget, their programs and activities? We have to provide appropriate oversight going forward.
Were you satisfied in the proposals for roads and transport brought in the budget for this year?
Personally not, and the minority in Parliament is also not, because the ministry is so strategic. Look at all those areas that we talked about. For instance, the various agencies, urban roads, feeder roads, and highways, they really, really need the resources, I mean the financial resources, to perform. And we're sort of mocking ourselves, Kwesi, because you see a whole ministry of roads and highways being provided. What they have now in the budget for capital expenditure is about 1 billion, which is not enough. And so we think that the government may be serious if it really talking about improving the road network in this country to provide appropriate resources. It's not just about the visions and all the, yes, the vision, but provide appropriate resources. Personally, I'm not too happy because I'm not seeing the payment, for instance, of the debt of contractors since 2013 up to date. Guess with road fund, get it cleared. And so that you start with the clean sheet. The road fund is a very good fund program or scheme. And the main function of road fund Kwesi is to ensure maintenance of our roads and rehabilitation and so on. And road fund now has good monies. Every year we have about 1.8 billion, unprecedented. And so if the decapping principle, the scheme of the Ministry of Finance, will want to take about 800 million out of this 1.8 billion, are we serious people? No. So personally, I'm not satisfied, but probably in the discussions, you can go into the details. And so I get worried when the Minister of Roads and Highways mounts the platform and talk with all confidence, so much we've done this. But he is handicapped because he hasn't got the resources to perform. But the key function of Kwesi is performance. You can have all those budgetary, whatever, and visions and so on. If the releases don't come, then the performance is a problem. So personally, because I've been the minister, I don't think that ministry is performing. The minister is really, really underperforming because he probably needs some resources.
So we have two problems. One, inadequate allocation of resources, and then untimely releases of the funds.
Exactly.
Two problems.
Exactly.
What can we do about the first part of the problem? Inadequate allocation of funds for roads.
I think that the government will have to be serious. And one of the channels that we can ensure that we have resources to maintain our basic problem Kwesi is our maintenance of our roads. The good people of the rural areas, Wasa East and Enchi and Co, do not necessarily need, they're not calling for tarred roads. They are calling for good roads. If it is graveled roads, appropriate pavement and so on, they are graveled and they are graded appropriately. And so I think that we need to provide a lot of funds for them. But we already have an avenue, road fund. Kwesi, in the past, during President Mahama's regime, NDC regime, in 2015, 2016, the road fund was getting 20% from the fuel deductions and so on, just 20 cities, 20 pesos. Then in 2016, we went to Parliament to request for an increase to 70 pesos. So that moved about 20 million cities a month now to 150 million Ghana cities. That includes the tolls and the weighing bridges and so on. So Kwesi, you can imagine that if we have $150 million coming into the kitty, so many things that we can do with maintenance of our roads and periodic and regular maintenance. Unfortunately, the releases are not happening as requested or as desired, and the decapping of the finance ministry of the 800 million Ghana cedis leaves that fund, problematic. So, but also a lot of loans. The government has initiated a lot of moves to take loans. After the loans, they're all over the place, and Sino-Hydro is the issue. So if these loans are, attracted, contracted outside, we need to see them in action. And you see, the Sino-Hydro is something else. We were expecting about 800 million Ghana cedis with all those touting of, year of roads and so on. It never happened. It failed woefully because the funds were not released. But I think that what we need is the appropriate injection of funds in that area. And I think if you do that, the other aspect of it is that Kwesi is that we need the personnel. They don't have the men, the engineers. We have currently, about 150 engineers in the whole sector. And can you imagine? They have over 4,000, 5,000 projects scattered all over. Now the minister says from now out to 2024, they're going to construct 6,000 roads, which we think, and I think they could do more because they have a lot of resources given the tax money and so on. And if you have 150 engineers who are going to supervise those projects. So I think that there's mismatch here. We need to get engineers, the technical staff in place, then you can go with the project. For all these that he's talking about, now we are told about over 2,000 projects, kilometer projects have been awarded, about 84 numbers. Now, who is going to supervise them? So eventually you are waiting to see bad work, and so on and so forth. So these are some of the things that if the government is really serious, first of all, make sure that appropriate funds are injected into the area and not just making budgetary allocation, bureaucracy, but releases, giving appropriate releases, the money should be released. And road funds should be free. Road funds should be free from this decapping and so on. But above all, we need to provide them with the human capital, the engineers, and the necessary human skills to supervise and do the designing and so on and so forth. That's what I think.
In simple, ordinary language, decapping of the fund, what is it?
The decapping of the fund is that introduction of the Akufo-Addo's government. I think about 15% or so of major statutory reductions, they will go there and just take what they think they have to take for something else, which we don't know. We talked against it. The minority in parliament have always talked against this, but I'm talking against this precisely for my sector, my area, roads and transport committee. So that decapping is the deductions that is made by the government on certain statutory deductions.
Which means that we are not using money accruing into the road fund for roads.
Exactly.
They are using it for other
something things. Something else. And the finance ministry is the right person or the right area to answer for that.
Well, viewers, we're talking to the Honorable Isaac Ajay Mensah, former Deputy Minister for Roads and Highways, and now Deputy Ranking Member for the Parliamentary Committee on Roads and Transport. We're going to go on a short break, and when we come back, I'd like to find out about the technical expertise available to the sector. We've spoken already about engineers. What is the problem in getting engineers for the sector? Short break.
Hello?
Oh,
she's here now. Okay, wait a minute. Why? Hey, my wife comes and I send a message. You're not supposed to be on the phone. Hello?
What's
happened? It's a child. I'm so young.
Biogas, swimming pool, plumbing works in Yinaso, Yeyebi, Freye, 0244-333-111,
and Nasa 0244-144-822. Me and Pa and Annette, you want swimming pool on me
see?
Me want
swimming
pool,
we'll
be
here.
Family drilling, I want to say. Family drilling.
Go fast,
Yana, shit. Me out with the
hello, welcome back to Talk Time, and we are talking about roads and roads and roads. And we are privileged to have in the studio a former Deputy Minister of Roads and Highways, or Roads and Transport, Honorable Isaac Ajay Mensah. And just before we went on the break, he indicated that sometimes finding the technical expertise for roads, for the supervision of roads, road construction, is difficult. What is the nature of the problem, sir?
We agree together in our committee. The ministry really also agree with us that they lack the technical know-how, the professionals, I mean the engineers. And in their report that they submitted, they had a area called challenges, and key, prominent among the challenges, the lack of staff. And so it is basically those who make things happen. And the sector has to do with professional guys who are engineers, civil engineers and so on. So if you don't have them and you have the ancillary people like the finance and HR and co, that is not the issue. The issue is that we need people with a technical know-how, the engineers who have the capacity and the skills to design, redesign and supervise and so on and so forth. So that is the matter. And I was just telling Pakusi, the minister in his report, and I learned that, I never monitored the press conference. I was in my constituency, but I learned that, and of course I've also read the publication and so on, that it's earmarked that 6,000 kilometers of roads will be constructed from now up to 2024. And already, over 2,200 and whatever has been awarded. And that is costing about 7.5 billion Ghana cedis and so on. So I asked myself, the ministry, in every report that they presented to us, because I was also a member of the previous committee, they talked about the same problem, numbers, engineers. The challenge is that, see the attrition level, a lot of them are going out. You know, when I was in the ministry, nice engineers, they are going out. But as and when they go out, we need to replace them. But I think that that authority isn't there to be able to replace engineers. So obviously the problem, and it's a very serious problem, and the minister knows that, and they all know it, and the president also knows that, and I think. So I think going forward, we need to be serious. You can't get all those projects that you say you're going to implement when you don't have Ghanaian engineers. These Chinese are coming with a Sino in money, and obviously they bring their men. But we need to have our own men to be able to look and get through those projects and make sure that they are doing the right thing. If you don't have them, package, you can imagine. So I think I'm not sure whether they get it. Otherwise, it's just a mere talk. No wonder that the year of roads in the first term just went into ditch and it didn't happen. Because one, the Sino hundred money never came. Two, even if they came, you didn't have the men. So I think going forward, they should immediately, and the minister should push it. He knows it. And I'm talking here on his behalf. And I think that if he has the opportunity to call, he'll call and confirm the same thing. It doesn't work if you don't get a man to supervise your project. And people question, if you don't have the man, why would you want to say all these things? And so we have doubts. Some people have doubts that because this government failed woefully in the first term on roads, year of roads, now our roads are bad. We, many of them, and I do also, you know, join that group, don't trust that the so-called vision on roads, 6,000 roads and go, will happen. I support that vision. I support the government. I support Nago Fado's good vision. You know, we're going to make roads and interchanges and so on. But you need to prove to people that because you couldn't do it in the past, what is the guarantee that you're going to do it going forward? And as time goes on, I think we can also go into the press conference, those areas that you talked about, the interchanges, the bridges, and the roads and so on.
So what can we concretely do to improve the number of expertise available to us, I mean, experts available to us, engineers and so on? Should we pay them more? Should we train more? What should we do?
I think all of them. We need to engage in massive recruitment. We have the engineers there. We have civil engineers all over. And we also need to pay them well, because if the pay is not good, they won't come. And you see, if they even accept the jobs and they come on board and they are not well catered for, certainly some of them will stay. But when they stay, that is why the undercutting and so comes in. So pay them well, because they are good engineers. Until I went to the ministry, I never knew that we have such competent and good people, nice people in the public sector. You know, but most of the good guys that I met have all gone out. So I think that immediately that massive recruitment should go on. I'm the one who doesn't support that when people have to go on retirement, we need to bring them back. But given the circumstances, given the challenges, I think that there wouldn't be anything wrong with the government attracting the living good engineers who are in their private consulting and so on to come in there and make sure that even if they bring in new engineers, you need to get people who will be bringing up to speed, training them and getting up to speed. We need to do this. And so the manning levels, you know, from HR perspective, the manning levels in terms of personal levels should be enhanced. Mm-hmm. And motivation and salary and co and so should all be made proper. Because that ministry is full of capital, you know, investment. It's money, so much money. So if you're bringing in money, so much money and so on, you need to make sure that the workers that you bring in, the engineers that you bring in, are well paid. And when they are well paid, I think they'll perform. So now we have that big gap. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we call it the personnel gap with the ministry.
One of the minister for roads is thumping his chest and saying that this year they're going to do 6,000 kilometers of roads. Where would these roads be? And what kind of roads are we going to do? Where are the roads? What's the rationale for doing 6,000 kilometers of roads this year?
I think Pak Kwesi, the minister, can be the best person to answer. And it's one of the questions that personally I've asked, and of course the minority do ask. We think that he can even do more. But as we speak, the Department of Federal Roads alone has about 3,000 projects running. And it's ongoing. Some stalled, some in the process, and many things. So because this government has been that government that has had so much money, tax money, and so much loans, we think that if this government is very serious on roads, we could fix it. And that is why we think that even the 6,000 that they're talking about is not enough. Because look at road fund, for instance, so much money. No government has had so much money than the Akufo-Addo's government. 1.8 billion. You know, we fixed this 20 pesos to 70 pesos thing in 2016. And you know, a whole lot of hullabaloo, you remember. We went to UBA for that mortgage, that mm-hmm. money. Because at the end of the year, you're going to get about 1.2 billion. So it makes sense to go for that because we owed workers, we owed contractors. There were some overload at that time, I think about 30 million or 50 million SNET money that the former President Kufo, you know, got to, you know, inject in the waste sector. So we needed to pay and contract. That is why we did mortgage that road fund thing to get money. But it was not, you know, long-lived. It was short-lived. Then MPP came on, 2017. So they benefited from this. They blasted in this. When we were living, we had almost about 600 million in that kitty. And they were not paying. And a whole lot of noise. And so on and so forth. Now, Pak Kwesi, they have every month the deductions for road fund is 150 million Ghana cedis a month. Can you imagine what 150 million cedis can do? Can do a lot. So this government has had so much money and they can do more. So we need to know also, where are these roads going to? Because we have system regions, Pak Kwesi, you know that?
Yeah.
And so for equity's sake, we need to know that now we have, the minister said we have 78,000, you know, kilometer road network in this country. And going forward, we need to be accountable. We need to know region by region, district by district, where these roads are. And so if he says that he's going to construct 6,000 roads going forward, we need to know. So he says that in this year, so much roads will go to Bono region. So much roads will go to, and so on and so forth. So that, I think you're right, asking that question. We need to know, because it will not be in the hands or capacity of the minister to determine which region or which district he loves because he visited them and so on and so forth. No, that equity should be there.
And there has to be some rationale.
Exactly.
One road over the other. In any case, one road that we've heard about over and over and over again is the Eastern Corridor Road. Is it included in the 6,000 kilometers of road that we want to do this year?
I think for the 6,000 that the minister is talking, he needs to come with the details. But in the budget, there were still some roads, Eastern Corridor roads, that Rolida is still on and so on. But I think for the 6,000 kilometer road, he needs to come out. Because Pak Kwesi, the minister or the ministry has committed themselves to the road sector medium-term infrastructure development or framework mm-hmm. from 2018 to 2021. Mm-hmm. In this, the issue of development of international corridor roads, including or fitting into the Western Corridor, Eastern Corridor, and Central Corridor routes, are part of it. And so I think that the minister will have to be more serious in making sure that this commitment, this road sector medium-term development framework, we started in 2018, has come into reality. And so more action will have to be taken. So I will not be surprised that this 6,000-kilometer road will cover the central corridor, the eastern corridor, and the western corridor. We need to know. If they are not in there, because the program is finished in 2021. And 2021, you have committed yourself to this medium-term development framework. Mm-hmm. That is ending this year. And so we want to know. The other one, also, Pakis, probably want to talk about is the issue of, in this policy, the issue of every capital, district capital road network must also be tarred or have to surface bitumen. It forms part of this, framework. So you can imagine all the districts, the new regions created, and the new districts as well must get all their roads sorted out and so on. So I think that the Eastern Corridor roads may have to, I'll be surprised if we don't find it in there.
Now, you also spoke about the principle of equity. But we know that some regions are more disadvantaged than others. I mean, the Volta region, for example, is known to be quite disadvantaged when it comes to infrastructural development. The minister has not provided the details yet, but from the budget, do you get the sense that disadvantaged regions will be catered for?
I don't think so. Because day in and day out, if you check from 2017, virtually most of the roads that were mentioned, the Eastern Corridor Road, the Volta Region Road, they are still featuring. And now they are still in there. So the question is that, do we trust it? We need to ring fence some resources and make sure that Volta Region lacks the roads. There were a couple of roads that NEC started, they were halted. And so it is not just a mere rhetoric. In 2017, they made mention of it. Virtually every budgetary allocation budget, they talk about it. Now, we don't see it. So we need to see some seriousness going forward, particularly with this plan of 6,000 roads that will be constructed from now to 2024. I don't get a feeling of equity. My sense of equity, Pakwesi, is that, for instance, if you check the total road network, we have about 78,000, as you said. You want to find out which of these roads are in Volta Region, and that which of these roads are in good, fair, and poor conditions, as they say. And so if the roads are good, fine, which are those roads? If the roads are bad, let's fix them. If the roads are poor, let's fix them. So I think that the sense of equity must be clear. And that is why when the ministry comes out clearly, getting to the public, the 6,000 roads are many that he has even, they've contracted out 2,200 over, kilometer roads. And we need to know, where are these roads going to? Is Volta Region covered and many things? Because they've signed a contract, and it's $7.5 billion going forward. And where are we going to get the funding? All those things we need to know.
No, your own constituency has a problem.
I know.
What will be done for your constituency, especially having regards to the fact that your constituency is one of the most resource-rich constituencies in the country?
Yeah. We are thankful to the NDC region president, Mahama, that some progress was made, but yet more to be done, particularly on feeder roads. So what President Mahama did was that those rich or resourced areas like Wasa East and the Sefi and so on, where we have the cocoa and the gold and so on, let's fix the feeder roads. So a lot of those roads were given a contract. Mm-hmm. But the challenge is that when this government came, Pakwesi, all these roads were suspended. And you can imagine the level of deprivation. The people are deprived. It's difficult even to carry the cocoa and many things out. These roads were left just like that. And so we hope, and in the budget, we have not seen anything for the constituency. Probably because I don't know whether it's a punishment for me, I don't know. But Wasa East is one of the deprived regions.
The Wasa East includes the Bwasi?
The Bwasi, yes.
Yeah.
They provide so much. In Sekedi Takoradi, Wasa East provide them with water, the Ghana Water Company. They take their water from Pratt in Dabwasi and Yaman. Mm-hmm. We have the you know the mines in Achampim, the Golden Star in Achampim. Then we have one the past paper and pulp company. Now it's we call them Sucknav, a new company. So the Wasa East provides so much, but roads are bad, and we lack certain resources. But we think that NDC will fix it. Though we started it, but it has been curtailed.
Well, viewers, we're going to go for another short break, and when we come back, we are still talking about roads and roads and roads. When we come back, we'll still be talking about roads, and one of the issues that I like to raise would be the role of local contractors as opposed to foreign contractors, and then aspects of the minister's press conference, and then we'll draw the curtains down. So, short break.
It's incredible! Bang on target!
Welcome back to Talk Time, and we are in conversation with Honorable Isaac Ajay Mensah. He used to be a deputy minister with responsibility for roads, and now is a deputy ranking member of the parliamentary committee, which also has responsibility for roads. Now, Honorable, not too long ago, there were many, many, many Ghanaian contractors taking part in the rehabilitation and construction of roads. Swedro contractors, KE and Sons, Bewa Civil Engineering and so on. They are all lost. What is happening?
Yeah. I think there are various reasons that we can go in there. It's also because of the structure of their companies. Some of them were family companies, and when they died, their sons and daughters couldn't hold up to them. And so they were probably not properly structured as a company. And so that might be one reason. The other reason is the fact that they owe them so much. And recently we learned that some contractors have even died because they have not been paid. I think we have to make it clear here whilst I'm here, because there are evidence to show that. As we speak, the road fund alone is indebted to the tune of almost 4 billion. That is 3.9, almost 4 billion to contractors. And that is, they call it since 2013. So backwards, you can imagine, if you owe a contractor 2013 and you're not paying this contractor because probably another, some government gave that contractor a contract, what are you talking about? And these guys have contracted loans from the banks. So what do you expect those people? Some of them too, they are dead. Sorry, Pakus. And the other aspect of it is the bank interest, the interest on the loans skyrocketing. And the government pays. We have what we call interest on delayed payment. And back, you see, the challenge is that the longer the monies are staying in the books, the bigger they become. Because now we have, for road fund alone, we have almost 4 billion. When are we going to pay? Because they are going up and going up day in and day out. And unfortunately, we've lost some of these contractors. Probably these contracts will have to come out. But some of them know that's their business. So long as they get other contracts and co, they are there going forward. But we need to clean the sheet that this money will have to be paid. It used to be 1.7 billion. Now it is almost 4 billion. It is sitting in the books. So the minister will have to make sure, Nana Akufo-Addo will have to make sure that these are money that we have to pay. And it is in the books. And it's growing day in and day out. The bank interest and so on are all getting up. So that is the challenge. There is, I'm told there are two, I know there are the two contractor associations, and they know it. But it's, that's the business, because if you don't speak well, you probably know the consequence. But this is in the books. That's roof on the loan. We don't know, as we speak now, we don't know how much is owed into GOG project. Huge. And that is a problem. So the minister will have to come out and let us know. I think in the press conference that he made, he never mentioned any indebtedness to the contractors regarding road fund and also other GOG projects that have not been paid for.
What about the difficulties in the banking sector? For example, we set up the Bank for Housing and Construction to provide support to local contractors. Collapsed.
It did.
So what about the arrangements in the banking sector and their impact on road construction? Interest rates.
Interest rates go up, certainly. No, these are these are business entities that also want to make profit. And so, you know, like you say, in the past, we had Bank for Construction. They are dead. And so that if the bankers, there can be a special package for the banks that these rank-fenced contractors, certified contractors, will have to be supported. But backwards, the challenge is that if you don't pay, the government is not paying. Now, can you imagine 1.8 billion Ghana cedis coming into the kitty? And that is, it, since, you know, Nana Akufo-Addo 2017, when he came to power, 1.8 billion. Every month, 150 million Ghana cedis are accruing into the kitty. Can't you do something about it? And all these bills are left unattended to going up. So I think that it's not impossible. It is possible for the government to have a special arrangement with the banks to give special dispensation to these contractors. And when that is done, the government will have to make sure that it redeems itself and pays all those monies and so on and so forth, giving out. And so when the contractor is not paid, Pakwesi, he works and is not paid, it certainly will affect the performance.
Now, not your colleague, but Mr. Martin Amidu, former special prosecutor,
yeah,
only a couple of days ago, made some worrying revelations.
Okay.
He claims that the NDC caucus in parliament negotiated with the MPP for the payment of some NDC contractors in exchange for repassing their incompetent ministers who were nominated. Is there any truth in this?
Bagusi, I think I'm not competent to go into this because I have no idea. I don't know when that happens. But that would be with the leadership. Of course, I'm a deputy ranking part of leadership, but I don't think that happened. You recall in the initial stages of this vetting and so on, there were a lot of complaints and agitation within and without that committee members have taken money and all those. That rumor all over. And so I don't think I'm competent here to talk about it.
But are there NDC contractors and MPP contractors, and how come?
I think, you
know, how come the contractors who are working for all of us, building roads that all of us use and so on, some of them are NDC contractors and some of them are MPP contractors? Does it make sense?
It does not. But you see, whether you like it or not, Parkways is there. They have been classified as such. But a smart businessman will always want to play with NDC, will always play MPP, whichever comes to power. That is business. And so on. So some of them will be ring fenced or tagged. This is an MPP contractor. One of these contractors, I can say, with precision, is Just More Construction Company Limited. Just More is one of the good contractors in this country. When Kufuor's period, President Kufuor's period, he was, you know, performing or working, so MPP contractor. When NDC came, and because he had the capacity and the skills and so on, we worked with Just More constructing the roads. NDC contractor. Now, I'll not be surprised if people say that now he's also working, he's an MP contractor. So those things are there. But those businessmen are smart to know how to manage the politicians. And good politicians should also be smart to manage this contractor, because they are going to perform. They are going to get you achieve your objective. So if you continue to tag them as MPP, then that is a problem. So I think it is there. Some of them are classified as NDC contractors. Because, Pakwesi, if you have performed, you were awarded a contract on the NDC, And now there comes a new government. And the government is not paying you for the work you've done. The government is saying, I've suspended all your votes. I'm conducting investigation into it. And they are not paying you. You are only the banks. Certainly, you'll be classified as an indigenous contractor. But some contractors, too, have been paid. And they've been given a contract. So obviously, that issue, dichotomy, NDC, MPP thing will still be there. But I think it's not the best thing going forward as a developing country. Forget about NDC, MPP. If you come and the person is able to perform, you can always build your people. Now, MPP they are building new contractors. Why not? But they are Ghanaian contractors. So I'll be surprised that when NDC comes to power, which is obvious, by 2025, with all these things happening, NDC will come to power. But so this same tact thing will be there. But I think, Pagos, you know that NEC is known for its massive infrastructure development, be it the health sector, the road sector, and but we need contractors to work with. So we work with people who are genuine, who conduct themselves very, very well, and we move forward as a nation.
Well, now I'm going to ask you to focus attention on the minister's famous press conference. What is your overall reaction to this famous press conference? I mean, overall reaction, no specific question.
Yeah.
What is it, this press conference, what does it tell you about the direction of the roads industry in our country?
Personally, I was disappointed in the delivery. Because here is a government that has failed woefully in the first time as far as roads were concerned. We have been in this country when the first term of Nana Akufo-Addo was flagged with a lot of good words, good roads, and so on. We're going to road construction, massive road construction. The park was the year of roads, you all know. And with the Sino-Hydro project or the Sino-Hydro scheme, a lot of roads were going to be constructed. Interchanges were going to be built, and so on. Over $800 million dollars was going to come from the China people, the Sino-Hydro, to construct roads. As we speak, it is only Tamale Interchange, which forms part of that Sino-Hydro project, that have seen some remarkable, progress. And I'm told it's about 65% or so. None of these roads or projects have seen any reasonable improvement. And some of these projects, contractors are not on site. There are a couple of them that, they cut short for all of them. One of them is my own in the backyard, the PTC interchange in Takoradi and Park Grant interchange. The sword was cut in the Vice President Bahumia was there to cut the sword. Nothing has happened. So that is why we say that actually Nana Akufo-Addo's first term was a total failure for road sector. That is clear. So if you have the opportunity, because people are complaining, the roads are bad. So the argument is that fix the roads. Then you come in to conduct your press conference. I would have expected that the minister will, in much sober manner, explain to them what have gone right and what have gone wrong in the past. And now they should give you an opportunity and trust them that going forward, this is what they want to do. But Kwesi, can you imagine? The minister thinks that, we have the total road network of 78,000. And he says, 41% good. And when they have performed 41% good and 33% fair and 20 whatever percent poor, they've done well. That is absolutely, unnecessary. If you are telling Ghanaians that your good roads in this country that can meet international standard is less than 50%, then it's a problem. The good roads in this country is less than 50%, 41%, Pakwesi, it's unacceptable. So it means that the volume of roads or the percentage of roads that do not meet the standard, the standard of good, is over 50%. That's almost about 59 or 58%. That I think that it's unnecessary that we have to be touting ourselves and we're doing well and we are doing well and so on and so forth. Pakwesi, can you imagine? From 2000, the late President Jerry Rawlings handed over power to Kufuor, the road initially, we had the total road network was about 37 a bit over 37,000 kilometers. That is the feeder routes, urban routes, and highways. By 2008, the road network has grown to about 67,000. Why did it grow to that level? Because of the creation of municipalities and metros. You know, those initial routes were suppressed and are not part of the database, had to be leased, because now urban roads will have to set up its office in a municipality or some municipalities that have been created. So over 10,000 kilometers of roads were released onto the network or onto data. That does not necessarily mean that they've constructed any new roads, because those roads are earth roads and so on, and they've come on board. So, Pakwesi, in 2001, now normally the survey is done, you know, for instance, 2001. The performance of the roads, and I want to credit the late President Rawlings, was 56% good. So that is above, you know, above the threshold of the 41% and so on. Mm-hmm. And so, and I learned that the minister was saying, no government ever can ever match Nana Akufo-Addo's, you know, record on roads. It's unacceptable. The records are in the industry
all the time. Yes. No government can match their industrialization. No government can match their roads.
You know,
no government can match food production. Hey,
so, but Pakwesi, it's on record. It's in the ministry. That as at the time that President Rawlings, that 2001, gave the baton to President Akufo, 2001, when the assessments were made, normally it's made from the previous year, and the results are open or they come out in the following year, 2001. The percentage of road performance was 56% good, that the road condition makes. Then the fair component was 70%, and the poor component was 27%. So you cannot say, even that time, 2017, the component of good for our roads was 45%. That is 2013. And that is why we started with the massive road networks construction and so on. So I think that my impression on that touting that, you know, they've constructed wonderful roads, I don't think that is justifiable. The other one is about the interchanges. He says they're going to construct 20 interchanges. That's fine. Super. It's good to have good vision, Pakwesi. It's good to have good projections. But the point is that where is the money? Where is the funding going to come from? There's nothing wrong if you have good visions. We want to see performance. The purpose interchange that he's talking about, somebody had to sit down, plan, seek for funding for that project. It's an NDC baby. Nana Akufo-Addo didn't do anything about it. I expect to see that when it is going to be commissioned, they will represent Mama to be there. President, let President Miss
Dilma. They're already saying that it was started from scratch by President Akufo-Addo. But the minister said so at his press conference.
Yeah, but the point is that, fine, you see, that's the point. Plans are always reviewed. The question is that, did he seek for any funding for the project? No. Somebody sat down and saw that we need this facility in this area here, this interchange in Pakwesi. It's a baby of President Mahama. And he sought funding. Pakwesi, look at this interchange here in Obechebe. Obechebe 1, Obechebe 2, it was President Mahama's baby. We sought funding for it, and it's there. The Tamamoto Way interchange, President Mahama's baby, he sought funding from JICA. So we are asking the minister, he should show us which one project, which one interchange that they've started and they've completed. Nothing. And the question is that in 2021, in the year of roads, 2020, we were supposed to have finished all those roads and interchanges. What is wrong? Two, they are saying that they're going to construct again 20 interchanges in, you know, 20 for the second term. So where are these 20 interchanges? Are they those old ones that they couldn't complete, or they are new ones that they're going to bring up? And two, what is the funding for them? And so I think that the government has little to show. The government has little to park. So we need to see, the government needs to show us which projects have they started and which projects have they ended. And so I get worried when the minister comes to, he's doing well, and I'm happy for him having big dreams. But Pakwesi, because he couldn't perform in the past, what is the guarantee that he'll perform? Now he has no personnel, he has no engineers to perform, and we want to know where the funding is coming from. The other one, Pakwesi, is the cocoa sector. The cocoa sector, the cocoa roads. Mm-hmm. Now as we speak, cocoa roads have rolled out, they say rolled out, about 303 contracts, totaling about 4,000 kilometers. They have rolled out. They have given out. The question is, I remember when Nana Akufo-Addo, you know, took power in 2017, he said he had suspended all roads and they were conducting investigations into them, and as and when necessary, they will proceed on that one. They have not brought any result for us to see. But very important, Pakwesi, is the Cocoa Road audit that they said we were going to do. They paid about 10 million cedis to the contractor. We have still not received the report. And minority in parliament is calling for that report. We need to see this report. Is it true that indeed there was even, you know, an audit work that took place, that we're talking so much about that? But most importantly and worrying, Pakwesi, is the fact that these roads were left to rot. They were left unattended to. And you can imagine the cost of, you know, what they call the loss of money to the state. All those remaining roads are something that if you consult the road, even when you have delivered them, Pakwesi, you need to maintain them. If you deliver the road and everything and you don't maintain, then you go bad. Then you have contractors on road constructing and everything. Then you stop them for 3-4 years. What do you expect? Now they said they have rolled out this new project. Are they the old ones that they are rolling out? All these are questions that we expect the minister to come up and talk about them. But above all, Pakwesi, is, you know, we talked about the decapping. Minority, I want to repeat here, minority would not support the government if they go ahead with the toll road, the increase again, because we think that we have enough money in the road fund, you know, and 1.8 billion money is coming in a year. That is enough. And if the government is not able to stop that decapping 800 million Ghana cedis, we're not going to support them. Because somebody will ask, Pakwesi, I ask you, why should somebody queue over hours to get to Kekos, you know, during the weekend and so on, just to pay? Because it's not free. What's somebody do that you're going to pay? So the government will have to go on. We started a lot of programs bringing in, you know, other private, you know, contractors and, you know, investors to come in to work on our tools and so on. All this is, we are not seeing anything about it. So all this is hanging on. And I can't imagine all those things that the minister was saying. For the 6,000 that we did discuss, he talked about the 6,000 kilos. Where are they going? Where is the issue of equity in them? And where is the funding coming from? And above all, if the minister says that 41% performance, the whole Ghana roads, you are only 41% good, that is bad. I never expected him to be saying that, because so much money has come into your hands, so much resources have all come into your hands, and we don't see them. You are telling us if you perform 41% good is enough. 2001, this will check the records, 56% of Ghana roads. In fact, at that time, it was 67,000 kilometers. But now it's 78,000. Pakwesi, even the 78,000, you don't need to say you're performing. It has never worked. I think the performance is very, very poor. The performance is bad. But whatever it is, we are ready to support the minister. One, for any action that he will take, I'm talking about committee, the minority, to ensure that they recruit more or good engineers into the ministry, so that all these things will not be the same as the first time, what they call it, year of road, and we never didn't see anything. Mm-hmm. We are in support. We will support the minister if he takes action to get the capping thing out, so that he could get his 800 million Ghana cedis to perform, to pay contractors. We'll be happy if the minister, or you support the minister, if he takes the appropriate action for the president or the minister of finance to pay the about four billion, cities debt with road fund. We will support the minister if he takes any action that, you know, will end up paying the GOG debt. We support him. But all this is hanging on. The roads, you have not seen them. You have not delivered any project you started and ended. Why all this? I expect the minister that guys are talking about fixing the roads. Indeed, our roads are bad. All they're talking about is the maintenance of our roads. And you have money sitting in there, have road fund, and you are not fixing it. So you are saying 41% good is enough, Pakwesi. So I think that together, you know, about 58% or whatever is there, that our roads do not meet the international standard. So my recommendation, my advice, I don't know what you're bringing on board, but I think that the minister need to pay attention to maintenance of our roads.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Honorable Isaac Ajay Mason. Well, we're listening to the Honorable. He's a member of the Parliamentary Committee responsible for roads. And he's been a deputy minister before with the same responsibility. We do hope that this conversation has provided a certain understanding of the state of our roads and what we're doing about the roads to improve them. I personally do not understand this fixation with interchanges. Interchanges, you know. But hey, can we understand everything? No, we can't understand everything. So this is where we draw the curtains down on Talk Time. But please stay with Pan-African Television, because undoubtedly this is the biggest television platform in Ghana today. And undoubtedly it is the biggest because it brings you the best in current affairs, best in entertainment, best in news, best in sports, whoa, best in everything. So stay with us until we meet you again next week. Bye-bye from all of us at Pan-African Television, especially our director, the director of the show, Adam Lumo, and the producer of the show, George Vinet. Bye-bye. We'll see you again very soon.